Ladies and gentlemen, Mornay Duplessis.
Consul General Thambo, ladies and gentlemen, if I just can say to the Consul General, I think when people go home tonight, they're going to remember your speech. A good friend of mine said it takes a long time to write a short speech. That is so true. Thank you very much for welcoming us. And thank you for having me with you today. Terry, you missed probably my most important claim to fame, and I think all the over 60s here will attest for that, and that is that I'm the only eighth man to have tackled Naas Botha properly. Yeah. If I can just bore you very briefly, because you've been gone so long, with a story. It happened in a semi-final at Loftus-Versfeld, and I was taken off the field. In those days, we only played North versus South. That was our big game. And, you know, there were a lot of political tensions in the country. And, of course, I wasn't that welcome at Loftus. And the police had to actually take me off the field. And one of the policemen that was guarding me after this late tackle, he said to me, and I hope I can just speak in Afrikaans for a minute, he said, "Jy's gelukkig ek is 'n policeman, anders het ek jou gedonder." Again, the story, and you might have heard it. I apologize if you have heard it before, but the wonderful the headline in the Sunday Times that day, this is going back 30 years, I apologize, was Mornay late on Naas. That is what we had to talk about in those days, was Mornay late on Naas, headline Sunday Times. I got back to Cape Town, and one of our wonderful Cape rugby supporters come running up to me, and he said, Morny, they call me Morny in Cape Town. He said, they say you tackled Naas late. Tell him you got there as fast as you could. Actually, if I could just say that I was on the front page once again after that. That was about, it was actually just a little bit before. And in about 1975, when I come from a school where some of the boys in the team come from in Bloemfontein, and I'd left Bloemfontein to go to Stellenbosch, and of course you get, you know, you've left your mates behind and so on, so I wasn't that popular in Stellenbosch, in Bloemfontein as well, and we played a trial match, a Springbok trial match, and my opposing number in the B team trials was a guy called Klinky Grobler. And Klinky, you can imagine, was this size. And Klinky and I had a go at each other in a line out, and for some reason, he landed right on the ball of my fist. It was in the days before there was a replay and all that sort of stuff. But there was a near right in Bloemfontein as well. And I was supposed to become the Springbok captain. I was in the pole seat to become the Springbok captain. There was a debate whether I can carry that mantle. And in fact, the Rand Daily Mail, does anybody remember a newspaper? Yeah. That shows your age, yeah. And the Rand Daily Mail, you get on the Bloemfontein, you get on the connecting flight, and I saw a guy with the Rand Daily Mail reading a headline in red, Mornay's fist shakes rugby world. And I really felt terrible about this, and you know, my parents and my school, and you know, what would they think of me? And again, this wasn't something to be proud of. But I got back to Cape Town, and again, wonderful that Cape humor. And a guy came up to me and he said, "Morny, let me shake the hand that shook the world." I sort of felt better about it. It's wonderful to be with you, and also to be with the Sevens team. Paul Sebastian, and marvelous job that you're doing. Kyle and the guys, thank you for today. Yes, I am here with a team. They actually are here with their team leaders. I belong to the glorious Sport for Good Foundation, and we are privileged to have assisted this young team. They're actually a team that belongs to a project that uses sport as a tool for social change, and it's actually a learn to play program. So it's not just about sport. And as we said today, the outcome of this trip perhaps is a Springbok in the making, but not important. More important is somebody, perhaps in 10 years' time, as a lawyer, doctor, teacher, who says that that trip changed my life. So I think them meeting you guys, Kyle, your motto of your team is touching people's lives. That's their motto, and I'd like you to give them a hand. This team. You know, the way you interacted, and just keep that up. Don't, when you become famous one day, remember, you always have to touch people's lives, and it's important. I mean, you are famous already, but I mean really famous. You know, it was a wonderful moment today. The boys were from Soweto, and I haven't met them. We've been to the projects, but there are thousands. These are 10 boys that have been selected from hundreds of boys that joined this project. And I said to the one boy, what's your name? And he said, praise the Lord. And I said, thank you very much, but what is your name? He said, praise the Lord. And that was his name. It was the most marvelous moment. In his passport, his name is praise the Lord. And, you know, that's life, and it's beautiful. They, in fact, two of them couldn't get their passports in time. I think, Jeff, and thanks very much again, if I could say, thank you for your support to let us bring these boys out. On the morning they leave, I think the flight leaves on the 5 o'clock on a Monday afternoon. And that morning they didn't have passports. And two advocates in Johannesburg, because they don't have parents to sign off their forms, got it right to get those two boys passports. And that's what South Africa is about. Briefly, and while we pray for the well-being of President Mandela, and it's fitting in this context of our team here touching other people's lives to mention and recall the words of this great man when he said 10 years ago now at the first glorious awards dinner that he said, sport has the power to change the world, it has the power to inspire, it has the power to unite people in the way that little else does. Sport can awaken hope where there was previously despair. And certainly, I can only attest to that. I have been very privileged. A lot of people ask me what I do in real life. And I've been very privileged to be involved at the Sports Science Institute in Cape Town with Professor Noakes and Sebastian, Alan, Paul, I can say even he's a graduate. These are scientists that have come through that institute. We formed the Sports Science Institute in Cape Town, and our aim and vision was, along with the belief that sport does have this power, was to create this medical research facility and science research facility that would endeavor to improve sporting performance of our youngsters. And not only sporting performance, but participation as well. Trophies, medals, and I suppose money earned today, we've got to say that, is a measure of modern sporting success, but we believe, and we certainly believe as a nation, that the ultimate value of a nation's sporting excellence and indeed participation is not the medals and the money, it's what it does to unify our country. In the same year, we opened the World Cup, the Sports Science Institute, the World Cup rugby in 95 happened in South Africa, and I was privileged to be part of that, and a team. South Africa rejoiced as a team of 14 white men and one black man beat the mighty All Blacks in the final. I'm sure some of you were there.